another light.
Thank you.
began his ministry to the world, led by the Spirit into the wilderness.
As we began our ministry, let us be led by our Spirit, even into the wilderness.
In those 40 days, and in that place, Jesus was faced with hunger, doubt, and temptation.
As we seek to follow Jesus, we will be led by him, even into the wilderness.
Jesus left the wilderness, faithful and obedient to God, rejoicing in the one in whom he trusted.
As we continue our path to the faithfulness, we will be led by our Christ, rejoicing in the Lord our God. Amen.
Please bow with me. O most gracious God, we gather this morning, set to journey together. A journey that might seem frivolous and unnecessary to some, yet painful for others. Show us the importance of this season and gather us together as a community of faith, willing to face the cross together. Be with us now in this time of worship. Draw us near. Calm our busy minds. Settle our hectic spirits. And let us truly experience your holy presence. Amen.
Our opening hymn is on page 189, Prayer for Jesus, singing verses 1 through 4.
Blessed are those whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered.
Blessed are those whom the Lord does not hold guilty, and whose spirit bears them to see.
When I did not declare my sin, my body wept. wasted away through my groaning all day long.
For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer.
I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not hide my iniquity.
I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. Then you forgave the guilt of my sin.
Therefore, let those who are godly offer prayer to you.
And in time of distress, the rush of the great waters shall not reach them.
You are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You encompass me with deliverance.
I will instruct you and teach you.
Like an unruly horse or a mule without understanding, whose temper must be curbed with grip and bridle.
Many are the plans of the wicked, but the steadfast love surrounds those who trust in the Lord.
Be glad in the Lord, and rejoice, O ye righteous.
Shout for joy, all ye upright in heart.
We'll now use the Apostles' Creed as our statement of faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. We all fall short in the eyes of one another and in the eyes of God. I would ask that you bow with me and pray our prayer of confession. God of infinite patience and love, we come to you this day, ready to embark on this Lenten journey, not sure if we want to make this spiritual trip. It is easy for us to get caught up in our own needs and our own anxieties. We are a people of great want, and we need to become a people of great faith. Stop us and remove us from the self-absorbed journey in which we live. Place us on your track of hope and salvation. Forgive our stubbornness and heal our sorrowful souls. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hear these words of assurance. You are loved by God. And in that love rest all safety, security, comfort, and hope. So rest, my friends, rest in God's love. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our joys and concerns this day are many. First of all, we continue to celebrate the remarkable progress toward healing that Neil Morrow has been just blessed with. I talked to Lindy, I guess yesterday, and she said that they are actually even considering discharging him from the hospital this coming week. That Tuesday, that in and of itself is just a miracle, and thanks be to God for that. Patty is in the hospital. They're not quite sure exactly what's going on with her fever, so we lift her. Barbara Gray remains in the hospital. hospital, but has come off the respirator and is doing much better. And we're glad for that, Marilyn. We celebrate that for y'all. Andy's still undergoing tests and treatments and therapy, and we just lift you and your family and the caregivers. Darlene lifts JR, who was in a car accident this week. There are several who have come to me and with prayer concerns of their heart, concerns of relationships, and those are being lifted this morning as just unspoken. God knows of those situations. And I would lift our own individual and fellowship journey through the Lenten season as well. I hope that you are participating and plan to participate in this important journey toward the cross. Are there others? Debbie?
I'm asked for prayer for Paisley as we head back to Vanderbilt Hospital Tuesday. They will be, after her heart surgery, she's now 7 years old, and they'll be checking new scans to see if any tumor has floaters and all kinds of things. And safe travel.
Safe travels as well as good results from the test and strength and all those many things. Wisdom on the part of the medical team.
Glenn's brother is going in tomorrow. He's been struggling for a year with this ablation of his heart and everything. So tomorrow they're going to do another ablation on the front and the back part of his heart. And it's just, we hope it works this time.
Yes. Glenn's brother, definitely, as he continues to battle this heart situation. Let us pray. O most holy, gracious God, loving God, creator God, here we are, the first Sunday in Lent. We come to you knowing that our hearts need cleansing, our spirits need restoration and healing. We need guidance. I ask that during this season of Lent that you journey with us and we journey together toward the cross with Christ. And then even beyond the cross to the resurrection. We know as people we'd rather just go ahead and skip to the happiness of Easter and enjoy the flowers and all the trimmings. But to fully experience the joy found that morning, we know that we need to experience the time of wilderness. We can't truly understand the power of the resurrection until we too have experienced the pain of the cross. Today we travel with our Savior as he encounters the enemy. Help us to learn from his experience and let it guide us and change us. God, we've lifted voices of names that need you in a special way. Those who need healing, comfort, peace, understanding, calm in the journey. I ask that you would send your Holy Spirit, Lord, to each and every one, those who were named and those who were just whispers. We know that you know each and every need and that you will provide as you know best. Be with us now, God, as we continue this time of worship. Open our ears that we might hear. Open our minds that we might learn. And open our spirits that we might experience. And as we leave this place this morning, help us to go boldly into the world to share what we know to be truth. Give us courage and give us strength as we journey this season. Amen. but today's a little bit special, and I'd like to ask our kids to join me down here on the steps.
Thank you.
1 through 11. The temptation of Jesus. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterward he was famished. The tempter came and said, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give to you if you will fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. The word of God for the people of God. So as we said, Lent did begin last Wednesday. We held an Ash Wednesday service here in our sanctuary. But to be honest, I've been preparing for Lent for weeks now. And as I've been reading and thinking about this season, I ran across an interesting quote. It says, "Lent is for life, not just for chocolate." Now, I think you can look at this statement two different ways. One would be to understand that real changes in our relationship with God take a lifetime. And it certainly can't be accomplished in just 40 short days. And then the other way to look at this, I think, is when you hear Lent for life, that would be to understand that real life changes would promote a new and better kind of life. And so all this got me to wondering, if we were to let God choose what we gave up for Lent, what do you think God would choose? Somehow I don't think very high on that list would be chocolate. All this to say this morning that we begin a Lenten series, a sermon series this morning, exploring different things that I think that God does want us to give up. Things that, should we do these things, that our lives would be changed beyond the 40 days of Lent. Things, behaviors that could improve the depth and the quality of our spiritual life. But I'll warn you, giving up these things is going to be tougher than giving up chocolate, or giving up Facebook, or giving up saying bad words, or even, yes, giving up caffeine. Today we're going to start with a big one, giving up control. I don't think there's anything that marks our society here in the United States more than the desire to have control over everything. Control over people and money, power. And if you don't believe me, just consider one item that is in almost every household in America that was not there, say, even 15, 20 years ago. The remote control Just for kicks, I started thinking and trying to count how many remote controls are in our house. And right off the bat, things like TVs and electronic equipment and things, I came up with 12. And I'm pretty sure I left out one or two along the way. Remote controls. But the point is that our world and our society hungers for control. And we want it, and we want it now. And we want it at our fingertips. We don't want to have to get up and walk across the room. But I ask you this, do you ever really have control? Think about it. Do we have control when high winds and tornadoes take out just huge swaths of land? Do we have control when terrorists rain down fear and terror on entire cities? Do we have control when millions of people in our world don't have housing, food, clean water? They're lonely, they're sick, they're hungry. Do we have control when our very own loved ones and our families and people we care about make choices that we know are going to be harmful in the end? And do we have control when the company we worked for downsizes and decides that our job is no longer necessary? And do we have control when that doctor enters that sterile, cold examining room with a diagnosis that scares the daylights out of you? Longing for control over our environment and our circumstances, our families and friends, even our own lives, that's a big illusion. But it's not a modern day problem either. Not hardly. Because the first lie that was ever told to us way back in the very beginning of time in the Garden of Eden was a lie about control. Remember, think back. The enemy said to them, Adam and Eve, you can have life on your terms and it can be a dream come true. You, apart from God, all by yourself, you should know what's good and what's evil. So take control. You make the choices. You can call the shots. You don't have to rely on anybody else for your wants, your wishes, your desires, your well-being. Well, the rest is history, of course. I'd say it hasn't worked out so well for us. It certainly hasn't been a dream come true. Our seeking control probably has pretty much been our worst nightmare. Think about it. Broken relationships, broken lives, lives forever after lived in fear. And guess what? Fear, that just makes you want to have more control. And then many, many years after that, not in the garden, but out in the dry, barren deserts, the enemy calls out again about having control. This time he offers Jesus the alternative. We heard it in the scripture. Control over power, control over hunger, control. But Jesus chooses trust over control. He trusts his Father completely. And the great deceiver said to him, you're the Son of God. So make these stones into bread. You can do it. Prove you're the God's immortal Son. See all that? You can be the authority. You can have all power. Now come on, Jesus. You know that a bird in the hand is worth two in the bush. How do you really, really know that God is trustworthy? Wouldn't you rather be in charge? Jesus in that moment could have taken control, and he could have had his home. were satisfied. His needs met. But he had confidence. He let go of control. And he chose to trust God's will in his life. He completely put himself in God's hand. And then if we fast forward again, we can again see Jesus' unwavering trust and giving up control. This time not in the desert, but again in the garden. This time the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus is facing a terrible time. He has a choice. He's praying with every part of his being to the point of even sweating blood. But he relinquishes his control and trusts his Father. And then if we fast forward again to the cross, we can ask, was it worth it? Fast forward to the empty tomb. Was giving up control worth it? You bet it was. Just like Aesop's fables, there's a lesson in each and every part of that story. And that is that we can either try to be in control, like Adam and Eve wanted to be, or we can let go of control and trust like Jesus. And to trust means that we live our lives in God's hands. We surrender our complete will to God's will. Or as the Big Blue Book says and the 12-step program says, we let go and let God. And boy, is that easier said than done. So what are you holding on to? What are you just clenching in your hands with white knuckles, controlling, that's not really useful or life-affirming? There are those of us who, being a bit smarter, we do hang on for a while, but then eventually your fingers get tired. You might be bumped or bruised, scraped, and so you realize that in your best interest, it's time to let go. And when we choose to unfurl our fingers and let go of that control and to accept the situations that we can't change and to just trust God with the outcomes, even though the outward circumstances may not change, we can feel comfortable because we've let go and we've let God. We can find that inner peace that really can't be explained. Nothing is different. No details in your life have changed around you, but there's that inner peace. A peace that, as Paul said, passes all understanding. A peace that allows us to see life in a new light through new lenses. I've shared with you before Frederick Buckner. He's an ordained Presbyterian minister and a great theologian. And he has this to say about the phrase, let go and let God. He says, if we want to turn in the direction of what is life-giving, we're going to have to let go of winter. Let go of the dark, which you wrap yourself in like a straitjacket, and let in the light. Stop trying to protect, to rescue, to judge, to manage the lives around you. Your children's lives, the lives of your husband, your wife, your partner, your friends. Because that is just what you are powerless to do. Remember that the lives of other people are not your business. They're their business. They're God's business. Because they all have God, whether they use the word God or not. Even your own life is not your business. business. It's God's business. Leave it to God. It's an astonishing thought. It can become a life-transforming thought. Now, if you're like most people, you're sitting there thinking about letting go of all control, and you might be feeling a little uncomfortable or squirming in your seat a little, because the words let go basically strike fear in the hearts of most people. Think about it. We're taught from a very early age that you are in control of your destiny, that a successful life is carefully planned and executed, that it's all up to you, that we're supposed to take the bull by the horns and just go out there and make things happen. So letting go is pretty much a foreign and uncomfortable concept to most of us. Letting go of control is basically not in our human DNA. There's a poem called Loosen My Grip by Ben Sterk, and it's found in a book called Guerrillas of Grace, Prayers for the Battle. This poem sheds some light on the kind of life that we could have if we choose to loosen our grip, let go of what we're trying to hold on to and to be in charge of and control, to let go and let God. Loosen my grip. Oh God, it's hard for me to let go. Please loosen my grip on those grudges and grievances I hold so closely, that I might risk exposing myself to the spirit of forgiving and forgiveness that changes things and resurrects dreams and courage. Loosen my grip on my fears. Release me a little into humility and into an acceptance of my humanity. Release me from the ominous fear of thinking some sin or failure of mine can even separate me from you. Release me from the dark fury of assuming I am unloved when the day calls for sacrifice and the night calls for courage. Loosen my grip on myself, for to reach out is to know myself held. To laugh at myself is to be carried on the easiness of your grace. To attend each moment is to hear the faint melody of eternity. Loosen my grip on my fears and fretfulness, so that letting go into the depths of silence, I might find myself held by you and linked anew to all life. And may I take to heart that you have taken me to your heart. This Lent, we're given the perfect chance, the wonderful, miraculous opportunity to practice letting go, to discover a deeper sense of belonging that comes when we trust God in the details. So I'm going to wrap this up with the same question that we've been talking about since early in planning for Lent. What are you giving up for Lent? How about, first of all, trying to give up control? Let go and let God. Amen. of possessions, things we have, things we try to collect. I ask that in this moment you help us to let go of some of that so that we can be participants in building your kingdom. Amen. Celebrate our great Thanksgiving, our Holy Communion this day, using a special Lenten liturgy. It's found in an insert in your bulletin. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You brought all things into being and called them good. From the dust of the earth, you formed us into your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your hope remained steadfast. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach the good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. During the 40 days of Lent, although the cross is a stumbling block and foolishness to many, nevertheless, we proclaim Christ's death on that cross for our sins, and not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. And we pray, gracious God, that we might be united to Christ Jesus and his sacrifice for us, and so be delivered from our slavery to sin and death. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks to you. He broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, gave the cup to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. By Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor, glory, and honor is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Jesus Christ has taught us, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. Because there is one loaf, though we are many, we are one body, for we all partake of one loaf. The bread which we break, it is a means of sharing in the body of Christ. And the cup over which we give thanks, it is a means of sharing in the outpoured blood of Christ. We will share in the method of communion called intinction. You will take a piece of the bread, dip it in the cup. On the altar, you have little crosses and burlap that were given out in Ash Wednesday. If you were not here and able to be a part of that and you would like to take one home as a remembrance of walking through the desert toward the cross, you are welcome to take one. You may spend time at the altar preparing yourself, releasing your control. If you prefer a single serving, your individual serving of communion, it is here as well. Janet, Craig, and